Hello, ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to Exotic Astrology. And today we have reached the seventh verse from the first canto, first chapter of the Srimad Bhagavatam. And we were just listening the other day about Sudh Goswami and why is he being given the elevated seat, which is known as Vyas Asan. All right. And we also saw in the last verse that who is a Goswami, one who is free from vices of Kali Yuga. He is a Goswami, he or she, anybody. And now we are going to see the words which praise Sudh Goswami again, but these are very important verses, okay? So we need to understand these verses because these verses are like the mood of the Srimad Bhagavatam, because the Srimad Bhagavatam is not just a theoretical study or a literature book or some poem or some, it's not some fancy book, or it's not some scientific, or I mean materially scientific, or it's not some fictional book, okay? So it talks of the highest level of spirituality. So therefore, it is essential that we acquaint ourselves with the mood of the author, which is Vyasdev. And therefore, it's very essential that we are in the right consciousness, in the right disposition. And that is something which will carry us throughout the Srimad Bhagavatam. And that is something which we need to carry throughout. And that is exactly like a password. So for example, if you see this mobile, you may see a mobile, but then there's password there, okay? So if you do like this, oops, then you will see that they will ask a password. So now anybody may have this mobile, but if they don't know the password, then they cannot use that mobile. Oh, that can be many, there can be different passwords. There is face ID, there is, you know, sound, or you type some numbers, that's the password. But the point is, there is a key for entering the mobile. So similarly, there is a key for entering into the divine scriptures, especially scriptures like the Srimad Bhagavatam, because they do not talk of any mundane material subject matter or any religious practices which will give you better things materially. It talks of spirit and God directly. So therefore, humility is very important, that and trying to see the good in others. These are very important qualities. And that's what is going. These are the things that we are seeing in the initial verses. Okay. Until now, we are still in the initial verses. Hopefully, we will get inside very fast. And the point is not to speed up and complete verses. That's not the agenda. We may need a million, billion lifetimes to complete, but that's not the problem. But the point is, we should understand every verse and we should read systematically. We should read thoroughly, as they say, read between the lines. But my guru used to say, no, don't read between the lines, read between the words also. All right, so the seventh verse from the first canto, first chapter of the Srimad Bhagavatam. And before we start, we will offer the prayers three times. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Agyanti Mirandhasya Gyananjana Shalakaya Chakshurun Militam Yena Tasmai Shri Guruve Namah. All right, so seventh verse of the first canto, first chapter. Yani Veda Vidam Sreshtho Bhagavan Badrayana Badrayana. That's Vyasdev. Reference to Vyasdev. Annecha Munaya Suta Paravana Vidho Vidu. The translation is, being the eldest learned Vedantist, O Sudh Goswami, you are acquainted with the knowledge of Vyasdev, who is the incarnation of Godhead. And you also know other sages who are fully versed in all kinds of physical and metaphysical knowledge. So Badrayana is a word used for Vyasadev. And here, Sudh Goswami, see what's mentioned here. You being the eldest learned Vedantist, O Sudh Goswami, you are acquainted with the knowledge of Vyasadev. Why is it said knowledge of Vyasadev? Because Vyasadev was the one who spoke the Bhagavatam to his son Sukhdev Goswami. And Sukhdev Goswami spoke it to Parikshit Maharaj and the assembled sages where this Sudh Goswami was sitting. And now this same Sudh Goswami is now coming to Naimisharanya forest where the sages are asking questions to him. And who is the leader of the sages? He is Shaunak Rishi in Naimisharanya. That I am reiterating again and again. Alright. And it's written, you are acquainted with the knowledge of Vyasadev, who is the incarnation of Godhead. Because Lord Vishnu has many incarnations. And one of the type of incarnations is Shaktiavesh Avatar, where a normal person is empowered specifically to do extraordinary activities which any normal human being cannot do. And that Shaktiavesh Avatar functions as if he is like Vishnu only. He is not directly Vishnu, he is a living being, but living being means he's a human being, but he's so empowered, he's so strong that there's no difference between him and Vishnu. It appears like that, at least externally, okay, and by his actions and his his teachings and by his inspiration and by his example and by his dealings also with people. So Vyasadev is not an ordinary person. He is the incarnation of Godhead. He is a Shaktiavesh Avatar. And Vyasa means anyone who compiles. So Vyasadev is referring to that person who has compiled all the scriptures, who is the son of Parashar and Satyavati, Parashar Muni and Satyavati. Alright, so now let us start the purport. Srimad Bhagavatam is a natural commentation on the Brahma Sutra or Badrayani Vedanta Sutras. It is called natural because Vyasadeva is author of both the Vedanta Sutras and Srimad Bhagavatam, or the essence of all Vedic literatures. Besides Vyasadeva, there are other sages who are the authors of six different philosophical systems, namely Gautama, Kanada, Kapila, Patanjali, Jaimini, and Ashtavakra. Theism is explained completely in the Vedanta Sutra. Where else in the other systems of philosophical speculations, practically no mention is given to the ultimate cause of all causes. One can sit on the Vyasasana only after being conversant in all systems of philosophy so that one can present fully the theistic views of the Bhagavatam in defiance to all other systems. Srila Sudh Goswami was the proper teacher, and therefore the sages at Naimisharanya elevated him to the Vyasasana. Srila Vyasadev is designated herein as the personality of Godhead because he is the authorized empowered incarnation. So lots of things in this verse. So let's start with the beginning. What is going on in the beginning of the verse? If you see, it's written that Srimad Bhagavatam is the natural commentary to the Vedanta Sutra. It is also known as Brahma Sutra or Badrayani Vedanta Sutras. So what is Vedanta? Vedanta, there are two words. One is Vedang, another is Vedant. So Vedanga refers to different limbs of the Vedas. Okay, for example, Jyotish, astrology, is one of the limbs of the Vedas. But Vedanta refers to the end, the conclusion of all the Vedas. Okay, and as Lord Krishna says in the Gita, Vedaischa sarver ahameva vedyo, Vedanta krit veda videva chaham. So Krishna says in the Gita that by all the Vedas I am to be known. He says that in the Bhagavad Gita very distinctly, very clearly. So when we say Ved, or when we say by all the Vedas, or when you say Vedic culture, it does not only refer to the four Vedas. Okay. So for example, the four Vedas, Rig Ved, Yajur Ved, Athar Ved, Sam Ved, it doesn't refer to only these. Of course, in a specific context, it might refer to all only these four. But at a generic sense, it refers to all the scriptures in the Sanatana Dharma, in the Vedic tradition. Okay, again, Vedic tradition. And so in this case, the Upanishads will also come under the Vedas or the Vedic system. The Puranas, 108 Upanishads, 18 Puranas are there. They also come under the Vedic canon. And Itihasas are there, Ramayana is there, Mahabharata is there. And Vedanta Sutra is referring to the end of the Vedas. Okay, so Vedanta Sutra is also written by the great sage Vyasadeva. And Sutra means short form. So Sutra means it is like not conclusion exactly. It's like missile, you can call a short missile. So for example, one of the sutras in the Vedanta Sutra is Raso Vaya Saha, and another sutra is there are many sutras. So Raso Vaya Saha means the absolute truth is the reservoir of all pleasure. So it's very precise, and that's why I said it's like a missile, you know, it directly goes and hits the target. So in this case, Raso Vaya Saha, it means that God, He is the source and the destination of all happiness. And similarly, there is, you know, another sutra like this, Anandamayo Bhyasat. So that means the soul is searching for Ananda, happiness. Anandamaya Abhyasa. Abhyasa means to do it every day, which means that the soul eternally, all the time, always, irrespective of anything, wants to be happy. Anandamayo Bhyasat. So the Vedanta Sutra and the sutras inside the Vedanta Sutra, they give us a conclusion of all the Vedic scriptures. And Srimad Bhagavatam is a commentary to the Vedanta Sutra. Commentary means, so suppose I write a book which is very complicated and then nobody understands. So then, now I have two options. I can either write another book where I can explain the earlier book line by line, but that's not a very good idea, because then that can again lead to more complications. So instead of that, what do I do? I write a book, this time a new book, a second book, where I explain the same thing that I explained in the earlier book, but not the way I did previously. I do it differently, and I do it in a way which is more acceptable and which can be understood very easily. Okay, so suppose I write a book of sutras where there are 10 rules of how to behave in life, how to be a good person. So similarly, now maybe I write another book, like maybe Ramayana. So there I describe how Lord Ram lived. So there, by the stories, we come to know that how a person should behave in his life. So that is like a commentary. So therefore, the Vedanta Sutra's natural commentary is the Srimad Bhagavatam. Alright. So therefore, Srimad Bhagavatam is like the explanation of the Vedanta Sutra. You can say like that. And therefore, because it's the commentary to the Vedanta Sutra, therefore it's a very special book in itself, because it talks of the highest spiritual truth. Besides Vyasadeva, and it's why is it called natural? Because Vyasadeva is the author of both the Vedanta Sutra and the Srimad Bhagavatam also. Or the essence of the Vedic literatures. There you go. Then there are different systems of philosophy, namely Gautama, Kanada, Kapila, Patanjali, Jaimini, and Ashtavakra. There are these six systems of philosophy about which we will discuss some other time. And theism is explained completely in the Vedanta Sutra, which means the position of God and the living being is very well established in the Vedanta Sutra and in the Bhagavatam also and in the Gita also. Theism is explained completely. Yeah. Whereas in other systems of philosophical speculations, practically no mention is given to the ultimate cause of all causes. One can sit on the Vyasasana only after being conversant in all systems of philosophy, so that one can present fully the theistic views of the Bhagavatam in defiance of all other systems. So this means the person who is sitting in the Vyasasana should also be aware of the other systems, because if you go and give a lecture in public, then not everybody out of 10, not more than one person will be interested in core spirituality, which the Bhagavatam talks about. So therefore, the guru should be able to establish the authority of the Bhagavatam. And for that, he should also be having a grasp of all the other systems of philosophy, because by that, he can prove it to you that why the Bhagavatam is superior to all of these. And superior not just in a dogmatic sense or not in a religious sense, but it talks of the highest level of spirituality. And therefore, the guru should be aware of all these systems also, so that he can present fully the theistic views of the Bhagavatam in defiance to all other systems. Srila Sudh Goswami was the proper teacher, and therefore the sages at Naimisharanya elevated him to the Vyas Asan. Srila Vyasdev is designated herein as the personality of Godhead, because he is the authorized, empowered incarnation. There you go. He is a Shaktyavesh Avatara. Okay. And if you read the translation again, knowledge of Vyasdev, who is the incarnation of Godhead, and you also know other sages who are fully versed in all kinds of physical and metaphysical knowledge. So there you go. It is mentioned all other sages. You know other sages who are well versed in physical and metaphysical knowledge. So this is referring to the mundane materialistic science, you know, physics, chemistry, mathematics. It can refer to astrology also, or astronomy. These kind of things also are indicated in that. Physical and metaphysical both. And therefore, Sudh Goswami, why he is very qualified? Because he has heard from Vyasdev, and he has also heard from all these other sages. Right? So he is knowledgeable about the material aspects of life also, and also the spiritual aspects of life. So therefore, his position is very unique. He is definitely a very great personality, and therefore he is the right authority to speak on the Srimad Bhagavatam. All right, because he has heard from Vyasdev. That is the most important criteria, and he has heard submissively. That is the next criteria, as we had discussed in the earlier verses. You know, just like reading and listening will not transform our lives or our heart, but when we listen with humility and without any ulterior motives, then our lives are transformed. All right, and therefore we should be very well versed in the Vedanta Sutra at least, or the Bhagavad Gita, or at the least in the Srimad Bhagavatam, so that we can talk to others, we can convince people that how taking to spirituality will transform their lives. They can be from any religion. They can be a Hindu or a Christian or a Muslim, or they can be a Buddhist. It doesn't matter. The point which Srimad Bhagavatam is trying to make is that material things can give you satisfaction to some extent, but beyond that, Vedanta Sutra, Anandamaya Abhyasa, the soul cannot be ultimately happy fully in this material world. And that is why focusing on the spirit is very important. And cultivating a relationship with God is even more important, because only then you can have a personal relationship with God. Like, for example, Krishna and Sudama, they were best of friends. Krishna and Arjuna, they were also best of friends. They were in one way cousins, but they were still best of friends. So if you see the example of Ram, Lord Ram and Sugriv, they were also very good friends. Lord Ram and Vibhishan, they were also very good friends. Lord Ram and anybody, I mean Jambavan, you know, Jambavan was very, very much senior to Lord Ram, and Lord Ram used to consider that Jambavan is almost like his guru. So Dasharatha Maharaj is father of Lord Ram. And then, so these are human relationships which obtain the highest perfection in spirituality. So when we will be able to rekindle our hidden love, which is there in our heart for God, only then the soul is happy, because all the things of this material world, they are temporary. So you may see a man and a woman laughing and joking and kissing each other and celebrating Valentine's Day or their marriage anniversary. But very soon after, in a matter of 60 to 70 years, assuming that they stay together, which is very rare in Kali Yuga these days, but even if you assume that they stay a very happy married life, like the perfect marriage made in heaven or made in earth or hell, wherever, by their karma, of course. Even if they stay, how long do they stay? They will stay at the max for 70 years or 80 years, not more than that. So from their perspective, it is their whole life. But if you see from an eternity perspective, that's nothing actually, 70, 80 years. Or it could happen that you both love each other, but after some years, you know, the husband dies or the wife dies. So, or in rare case, maybe you both die together, but that's very rare. Always one dies earlier and then the other one has to suffer and, you know, stay in seclusion and loneliness because of that person's absence. And even if you stay together for 8 years and you die together the same day, even then you are dying, you are separating. So the material things, either it's human beings or any objects, they have a limited time frame. And if they don't have, even if they have an unlimited time frame, we have a limited time frame, means our body is limited. So for example, somebody says, you know, I like to eat gulab jamuns. How many gulab jamuns can you eat? 50, 60, you know, in a day, not more than say 50. That's like the limit. So even if there are thousands of shops which make gulab jamuns every day, but our capacity is limited. So either the resources are limited or our capacity to enjoy those resources, they are limited, because ananda mayo bhyasa, the soul is always looking for eternal pleasure, unlimited pleasure, raso vaisaha, which we can only find when we look towards divinity. Otherwise, we will be rotting in this material world and we will be thinking that we are very happy, but then we will only be miserable and we will also make others miserable. All right, so let us not make ourselves and others miserable. And therefore, we should hear from authorities like Sudh Goswami, Sukhdev Goswami, and Vyasdev, and all other sages like Shaunak Rishi, and the great sages assembled in the Naimi Sharanya forest, which we will do very well in the next verses and in all the verses of the Srimad Bhagavatam. All right. So that is it from my side. If you like this video, click the thumbs up and share it with somebody who wants to learn the science of God and spirituality. And If you are new to the channel, please subscribe to it. And if you want a consultation from me, then please go down to the description section where you'll find the link to my website. All right. God is there with you all the time. Just look to him and you must find him. No, don't worry. You will find him, or he will find you. All right. Bye-bye.